Well, I guess it's close enough to time that we can start the session. I hope that Macarius doesn't require any introduction to us. So we should just let him go ahead and tell us about Isabel news and trends in 2020.
Yeah. Okay, Larry, can you make sure that in this tiny video that I'm focused somehow, there is this that I'm spotlighted. Okay, so yeah, so the introduction is maybe required. So I'm in the past 5 years, or since 5 years, I'm living here in Augsburg, which is a very nice city, and this is my new headquarter. And my virtual headquarter is the Skettisnet website, and it's sort of an intermediate report about yeah, decades of Isabel news and trends, in particular news about the release from 2 months ago, but also general situation, what are we doing and what is to be expected for the future and so on. And well, Isabel, it's for my part, it's all centered about the release process. So every 10 months since 2007, every 8 to 10 months, there's a release, and all my life is sort of organized according to this cycle that for vacation or when I'm on travel or whatever, I need to plan for the release cycle every 10 months, practically. Sometimes it's quicker. And we have before the release, 4 to 8 weeks consolidation with 3 to 5 release candidates before the release. And then the release is finalized, and there will be no patches after a release. This is very important. And when release candidates show up, then people should consider this as something like a pre-release and start experimenting and reporting problems. Then there's still a chance to change it. And when it's final, there's no chance to change. For the ongoing release process in these 4 to 8 weeks, there's now this block here on the, so here we have two blocks, Isabel release. And I did this for the first time here to explain how it's going to happen, and then to update this block entry about the release candidates and so on. And whenever we are in the hot release phase, then here you will see what's going on, and you can download the release candidates and follow that. The current release is the April 2020 version, and 10 months plus April will be then February 2021, presumably. So this will be a winter release, and it will presumably be a year with two releases. But first, let's first think about this. Yeah, so there might be then another winter release in 2021. Consolidation phase, so the last week of the year, and then 6 weeks into the next year. And as we proceed towards a release, between the release cycles, the repository versions are relevant, and the news as they're coming in and being discussed and so on, there's now also a block for that, for the news. And it's populated by myself, but other people who contribute to the repository are invited to also add things to their to this block there when there's something to announce. Okay, so this is the core platform, the core Isabel platform with its release cycle. On top of that, we have Isabel applications, and most of them are in Archive of Formal Proofs. Everybody knows this. This is our highly successful garden, or this library, and Fabian Huch had this very nice picture there with the, all these books being piled up and so on. The main website is well known. The repositories are now here on this new French hosting platform. Gavin did this last week, I think. This is GitLab clone, and it looks very nice to me. This looks like these quite decent here, so I hope that we will be rather happy with it, and the company will flourish and prosper. These are some smart guys doing nice things. Okay, AFP at the moment, 550 articles, 350 authors, 12,000 theories, 120,000 theorems, 2 million formal items. Formal items means these low-level things that you see exported. We had this in the other talks, the foundational view on that. It's managed by these editors and Yeah, most people in this virtual room, they know how this works. So you submit your material and some of the guys will pick this up and then it will end up eventually on the website and in the repository and so on. So this really works very well. And I think this is very distinctive. The other prover communities, they don't have this, that's a solid platform. And then this garden, this huge garden, this playground with all the applications maintained in a nice way. So we can be proud of ourselves as a community that this works. So for looking towards the top, looking towards the bottom, we have the critical infrastructure of Isabel. And this is my definition of infrastructure. This is what you only see when it does not work. So the infrastructure is below the level of visibility normally. And we've had the discussion about this dump tool and performance problems and resource problems there in the other session. And in such situations, you see a little bit of the infrastructure because there are things that don't work or they require a machine with 120 gigabytes of RAM or something like that. So at the bottom, we have these two people, David Matthews in Edinburgh, doing the PolyML platform since 1985. And myself being located in Augsburg, and I'm responsible for Isabel ML Scala PIDE platform. All this multilingual complexity and all this fitting things together and so on. And both of these people are basically one man businesses and actually enterprises. I'm an enterprise, I'm not a business, I'm an entrepreneur. And the question is about funding these peoples. And this is just what has happened already. And there might be better ideas or other ideas or donations. So it means donations of money. support contracts. We've had this occasionally in the past that somebody had a project and then a budget for software maintenance and they just directed the budget to somebody who can make use of that. Or development constructs with specific focus and direction. So for David Matthews, we did this quite often and all the great things he did for us. So PolyML is this platform. It was great on its own. It was made much more great for us. And people managed to get some funding and directed towards David Matthews. And then we had the discussions what to do there and to scale this up for, yeah, to support AFP. For myself, I also had this occasionally recently. So the most successful one recently was this Isabel MMT project with Michael Kohlhaas and Florian Raabe and all this Isabel dump and Isabel export and these things came out of that. And then immediately where there were all these other applications coming from it. I always do it in a way that everybody benefits. It's not that somebody says, I want to have that feature. Can you do this? And I have $1 million for that. So I usually say, well, what is your project? What do you need? And how does it fit to the general ecosystem of Isabel? And how can we do this in a way that everybody will benefit from the results in a certain way? Okay, and there might be much better ideas and maybe people have ideas of somehow sort of, yeah, finding appendices in projects where you have a big budget and you can subtract a small budget that is directed to one of these two key people. And the better we manage as a community to do that, the better this huge tower of applications, the archive of formal proof, and can continue to grow on top of it. This is a really, really huge tower. Okay, so this is a general introduction. And now news and trends for the Isabel 2020 release. And this is basically the news file put into some order with some comments, what is to be expected. Distinctive session directories. So this session root specification now has this directories keyword, and you need to specify which are your additional directories that you want to refer to in your session. Because you have to be explicit now about this, the IDE startup is much faster because it's statically declared what are your directories, where your sources are. Normally, there's just one directory. And if you have additional directories, you need to specify them here. And this is exclusive, so a different session cannot specify the same directory again. And the problem is for the IDE, when there's a file, it needs to find out which session owns this file. And by looking at a directory, then it's easy to find. A corollary of that is, or the motivation of these formal arrangements is to have session qualified theories. I started this in 2017, and it turned out very, very challenging and difficult. And now after this, the fourth release where this is in, it's sort of settled. It's not fully settled yet. There's some open fine points or some nice to have things. And at some point I considering sort of to replace, sometimes people group their things into directories, and can we group this more directly to have a tag, which topic it belongs. There are application of directories, and we need to sort this out. There were some mails on the mailing list, and I didn't study this yet. So I need to study this. What are really the needs there? And can we reduce the complexity that is in there still with the subdirectories? And there is some complexity, because 2 weeks after release, somebody pointed out that it's not quite working as before. And so this was an example for somebody who expected that after a release, something can be changed. But he was 2 weeks late or 4 weeks late. So I need to sort this out soon. And for the next release, there will be another small change there with the directories and maybe some tagging and moving more towards a logical organization of sources and not physical directories that cause so many worries in the concepts. And a different thing that can be added on top, this is not related here, but everything is session qualified anyway. Session.theory is the theory name, but the theory namespace is only the namespace, the base name. So this is hol.nut, and then we only have nut.something. And can we have the full name here as an internal name? And then you can merge theories arbitrarily because the sessions will already distinguish that. Let's say there's an array theory here, an array theory there, in different sessions. And right now you cannot merge that. And many applications need this, and this will be another big step, because then many tools will break down and so on, but this will happen eventually. Okay, the next topic. Accurate proof digest with full tracking of oracles. So I spent a lot of time on the inference kernel. This was motivated by Isabel MMT also and Isabel Dedukti. And there is now an accurate tracking of dependencies, yeah, on oracles. So when you produce a theorem, what are its oracles and what are other theorems that it uses? And the graph of dependencies is taking into account the inferences of the type class system in the logic. And this was never implemented, and we never claimed that this would work. It was just added as a partially implemented features many, many years ago in 1994. And now for the first time, we claim that this works. So if something still doesn't work, then this is really broken and we need to refine this again. But this is the first time that we make any claims on that. And I reworked the inference kernel, so it's really now just the structure THM and no circular dependency on the structure X class. So half of the X class structure is now in THM. And this is, it was always the biggest microkernel on the planet. And now it's even bigger, but the advantage is it's just that module and its imported modules and not a circular dependency on this other module with 42 modules in between that are not related. So the kernel structure has now become more explicit. And there are two commands now, theorem oracles to print all the oracles of given theorems. Theorem depths is now a different command. The old theorem depths has been discontinued. And it's just, yeah, the immediate dependencies concerning the theorem namespace. And all this change of the inference kernel has an estimated performance impact of maybe up to 5% slower than before. Yeah, and it's more obvious, it's more stable and more serious and more what people have expected in the last 20 years usually. But now I hope that this is really working. Okay, more exports in Isabel Scala with proof terms. So this is somehow related and was actually the reworking of the kernel was a prerequisite for some applications with exports. So I added, for Isabel MMT mostly, I added more information about structured specifications. When you write a primrec, then you get an exported information that is somehow related. Since your function is primitive recursive, or something like that. I also changed this. We've seen this in Fabian Such talk, fact, the fact namespace. A fact is a name and it refers to many internal derivations. This is a multi-fact, so to say. And we have this notation to project out parts, one theorem. And for the export, I've changed this now that you get these parts. Because when I export to deductee or to MMT, this is what they expect. They don't expect multiple facts, they expect individual facts. And it's like a constant. This fits better. So it's just this funny name now exported. And then sometimes some name mangling is required. There's also the dependency graph. Everything is now tracked internally. And I export a dependency graph. And then we have 2 million nodes, so types, consts, and theorems for AFP, and 400 million edges between these nodes. There's a lot of duplication. So when you write data type, and there's a lot of redundancy in there. But it's, and I'm expecting some applications from that eventually, that people somehow do digest this or mine the data here, this huge graph. This is a foundational graph over AFP. Proof terms are also exported this option, and this doesn't quite scale, but we manage for Isabel deductee up till until whole list. Whole list works in Isabel deductee. This is a project with Cachon, Paris Cachon. This is not published yet. This was really, really hard work to get to the point. And Isabel users, they know that whole list is almost nothing. But foundationally, it's a lot what's going in there. And the Isabel dumb tool, I reworked this so many times, and still we had a discussion before. Still situations where it breaks down. Okay. Yeah, MMT was this. Michael Kolas and Florian Rabe, they really managed to get a lot of money for that. So I spent these 2 years there to do a lot of things, and everybody will benefit from that. Isabel deductee, where we spent a couple of weeks. Michael Ferber is a postdoc at Cachon. He will leave in a couple of weeks, maybe. So I was visiting them 2 times, and then we were doing a few things. Isabel Dam started out as a skeleton to make an export application. And the idea was that MMT is a different repository. When something changes, then the Dam tool will break, and then I update the Dam tool, and then I can update Isabel MMT accordingly. But now Dam has grown into a huge thing, and it's a thing in its own right. And this is good. So we have these search tools, or there might be machine learning things that extract funny data using dumps and so on. Isabel build is not Isabel dump. Isabel build is a batch build and it requires less resources. It doesn't have PIDE markup. This is not PIDE. And the distinction will remain. And presently I'm struggling with that. I'm trying to upgrade build to have a few little PIDE protocol tricks in there. In particular, it should be able to invoke Scala functions from ML. This works already, but on the mailing list, on the Isabel Dev mailing list, we have some observations that resource problems. And I need to sit down again some days and weeks and to find out, yeah, maybe Scala, maybe Java resource problems. So this is often a mystery to me what the JVM is doing. Okay, next item, Isabel Jaded. So very little has happened there. I was busy in the other parts. And shortly before the release, I did some small things where many people were asking for over a long time. So to have actions that you can retrieve the tooltip messages with the keyboard, actions to navigate errors in the source, default font sizes for Linux are a bit better, anti-aliasing for Linux is a bit better. after the release, the Jaded platform was renovated because one of the guys is a French guy, and he was really in this full French lockdown where everybody was imprisoned, and he spent many weeks to update the code base. And this is already in the after release Isabel repository that we now have an update on JEdit, on the editor. And the trends here are not Jaded up trends, but Isabel Jaded trends. So ideas, obvious ideas for the next big things for Isabel Jaded that I would like to tackle eventually, like built-in support for version control in the quality of Visual Studio code, where you don't have to think about it, you just use it. And in a way that it works for us, it works for Isabel and AFP, that we don't have to explain to mathematicians what version control is, they should just use it, and it should just work, and nobody has to speak about it. Or to have a dockable window for prover messages with support for tracing messages, tree structure, incremental, high volume tracing messages, and so on, obvious, a reform of the proof state dockable with buttons and clickable output. Florian Huffman has made this extract proof tool, where EtherProof is generated from the proof state. And this could be just in the state dockable to click a button, generate Ether outline for that. So these are rather obvious ideas in the pipeline for many years already. Somebody pointed out that the search dialogue in VS Code is so great. And I basically agree. The Jaded dialogue is also great, but it was really great 15 years ago, and it might be better to imitate VS Code incremental search now in our great IDE to have the best ideas transferred. For Isabel VS Code, I didn't do much. There was a contribution about the update of the web view panel. This is a new API. You get more direct access to a restricted Chromium web browser. And this 2020 release, it now works again. This was the day when it was released. I didn't check. So maybe it's broken again. So I hope that it still works. I cannot check daily if this is still working. Isabel VS Code will somehow continue, but this is just an experiment. This is not a production platform. This is to learn from this platform. And eventually I will move more and more ideas from it to Isabel Jaded. So I'm mostly committed to continue Isabel Jaded as a IDE platform and not have too much VS Code and not too much web interface technology. Isabel ML, there were some small changes in the scalability of exports. We did some small things to have a soft type system in the Pure framework. And we had very ambitious plans for the Paris meeting, and the Paris meeting was basically canceled. We have the virtual Paris meeting, so we have virtually nothing there at the moment apart from experiments somewhere. So at some point, there will be really great soft type systems in object logics needs to be put into shape. A small thing that might be very useful, we can now browse the PolyML compiler in the IDE. So if you just open this root file here, then this is David Matthew's root file for the compiler, and you just jump somewhere in there, and then you see how David Matthews is implementing his compiler, let's say here. And then in the usual way, you can explore this. And this might be relevant for projects that somehow work with the PolyML compiler, work on it to improve it or to learn how this works. Trends, so PolyML will continue like in the last 3 decades. I will rather soon make improved Isabel ML monitoring, heap sizing, timings of the garbage collection. This will be done in a way that when the ML system is busy, the runtime system will do the timing there and hand it over to the IDE directly without the ML system. And then we have all these ping out effects there that you nothing is happening in the IDE. You can still get monitoring that you see that the ML process is very busy or something like that. I will do this rather soon because the applications are getting so huge now. that this is needed to figure out why it breaks down. Scala IDE support. We've had this already in a discussion before. A producer Gradle project, you can import this into IntelliJ, and then you can just go through that. So this is the Scala IDE there, Scala project. And then I have my IntelliJ. Let's say I want to explore how this is done here. This is Isabel Scala. It's really a Scala IDE where I have all the information of the static phase. And I hope that more people will dare to make Isabel Scala tools. Self-hosted development platform, I will not say much about it because the time has run out. So please go there if you want to see what's going on. And we have all the relevant things, AFP, PolyML, Isabel, assembled there, and then the people being busy on it. Then you also see that most of the work is now on AFP. This is where the infrastructure continues, but there's not so much noise there. It continues quietly. Yeah, self-hosting of infrastructure is ideologically important for Isabel. It has been there all the time. And in recent years, I'm becoming more and more explicit about that. It saves a lot of energy if you have it hosted yourself. Okay, that's it. We have time for questions.
Thank you, Makari. Any questions?
Yes. Makarios, can you say a few more words about the soft type system? I didn't understand at what level that was.
Yeah, Alex Kraus is the one. So the Innsbruck guys have some work there with MISA and with set theory and so on. And this is just that in Pure, there is a hook to install certain operations for static analysis of what you enter into the logic. It's very basic, very minimal. And yeah, the actual work is done in Innsbruck or some other applications.
But this is not a syntax phase. It's a different place to hook things in.
So when I enter a term, then there are certain phases going on and there's just more ways to get into this process and to augment the context in certain situations. Mm-hmm. So we planned to have an IJCA paper, but this didn't happen for various reasons. We were too slow and then too many problems on the planet happened also. So this is delayed and for next year, maybe. Let's see if we manage to cumulative. So this is Innsbruck and Alex Kraus and myself doing a few small things.
I still don't understand it, but yeah.
Makarios, is it planned to stay with Mercurial as a version management?
Yes. 2 years ago, you had the same question, and I spent so much energy on this question. Definitely yes. So there's no reason to go to Git. This is just bad press, so to say. And if you would want to move the Isabel repository away from Mercurial, you would cut off one arm and one leg. You cannot transfer the history unharmed. And the history is vital. It's more important than the source. For AFP, you could somehow do this and cut only fingers off, not one arm and one leg. But then you have the one on Git and the one on Mercurial, and then the great IDE things that are coming will not work. So what is the gain? And then you have centralized, I wrote there somewhere centralized version control. So GitHub is centralized, Bitbucket is centralized, GitLab is centralized. If you subtract that, then you have fringe people doing their own hosting. And then I stay with my fringe friends here with the fringe group of Mercurial.
Just a practical thing, what you mentioned about funding. I don't know if the DFG could help, perhaps, if you have looked into that.
Pardon? Into what?
The DFG, could it help with funding?
The I Deutsche don't understand.
Forschungsgemeinschaft.
Ah, DFG. No, so it needs to be some sort of semi, this is not academic funding. So we are doing technology, And sometimes in an academic project, you can have small budgets to say, we have some kind of external contributors who provide some technology. So I did this in an EU project with, so Michael Kohlhaas and Florian Rabe had an EU project, and then they said, yeah, we need some technology, and we spend a couple of euros there on having somebody implement something. This is the kind of thing. It's not about research funding. What technology, producing technology is not a research, academic research project.
Makarios, a quick question on the infrastructure for extracting the graph from proof terms. Any time frame or roadmap for that to be stable?
Well, it depends on the next EU project. So we, with the French colleagues, we have something in the pipeline, and if this happens, then there's a plan for that, and it will be next year and a year or the next 2.5 years and something like that. If this doesn't happen,
so the process is still in the funding.
So it's under it's in the process. The project proposal is in the process. There's no reply yet on. But this is what I did in January. We were all meeting in France to have this deductee, this Isabelle deductee, sort of academically funded. And then there are then people like me in the project to get some money to improve the architecture, the technology, that this really works. So this is a, what we did here is an academic implementation. This is really huge for an academic implementation. But to make this really work for AFP, this is so huge, you need substantial extra funding. And if this project proposal is accepted, it will happen then starting next year. And if it's not accepted, then there might be something else coming eventually, but it will take longer then.
Thank you. That will be very useful for what we're trying to do. We've been
looking at what is your name? I don't see you. I'm blind here on. Can you see
it's Janos.
Ah, okay.